This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so let me now share my screen. I hope everybody could see that. Oh. All right. A little introduction. So when talking about industrial network, we are often taken to specific application-driven tasks, both commercial and technical. And this is quite natural for all of us while we are involved normally in the direct machine automation. And sometimes we do not take a look often to the meaning and the perspective of the connectivity at different or wider viewpoint. Not to mention that the variety of protocol are so wide and still evolving that is often not so easy to find the right compass to orientate among the various proposals and the various protocols. So today, with the help of our software expert, Pietro Marinone and Raffaele Recchi, I will try to navigate with you across this large universe of connectivity. So let me start with a couple of numbers. This is the result of research made last year by a large investment bank, Morgan Stanley, try to verify which was and which will be the size of the industrial Internet of Things sector in the worldwide market. We are talking about industrial Internet of Things, not commercial or consumer IoT. This data is anyway very big. So just in the 2018 was the range of $160 billion, and is expected to grow with a compound annual growth rate of more than 20%, reaching more than $600 billion at the 2025. So in order to understand this phenomenon, I made an exercise, try to look at the connectivity at two different layers. So I call micro level the one that we know better, which is the machine on anyway the production cell level of the operation. So in this perspective, the most immediate advantage for sure is a large reduction of cost for manpower related to the wiring operation, less probability of errors, and a shorter time for the manufacturing itself. But the advantages are much larger than that. So the protocol standardization allow much more flexibility in the selection of the parts by the manufacturer. The tuning and the setup operation previously made normally offline can now be done at the PLC or at the master controller level. So the upper level connectivity to the internet allow remote update, debug, dropping down dramatically the technical support cost and the maintenance cost, while they are remotely supported by specialized technical team. And now let me just drop you a thinking or a question. Maybe we speak about this later on at the end. So, but the thinking is that, do you feel like we do, that nowadays already in the machine design engineering, we are seeing a migration from the typical electrical and electronic skill to software and programming skill? We think like that. And as an example, the last hiring we made in RTA as an engineer were software engineer, and we have created a specific software development department. But maybe after I would like to listen your thinking about that. So, but now let's observe that scenario from a different angle. This is what I call the macro level. So gradually during the last 20 years, we observed a narrowing of the gap between information technology and operational technology. This process came to a real integration during these years, and this is one of the most important trend in the actual industrial manufacturing. I left intentionally the timeline on the top blank, simply because while this process is general in the industrial manufacturing and present worldwide, the timing of the operation is different depending on variables like the size of the company, the sector where they are operating, in the region where are they located. But the integration process is one of the reasons why the data transfer and the scalable connectivity are getting so great portion in the modern engineering design. And let's see in a little bit more detail now. This is what it's called the today's architecture manufacturing operation. So it's called the automation pyramid. Going from the top to the bottom, we have the ERP for enterprise management, then MES for the planning, for the production planning, SCADA for supervisory, and at the level 1 and 2, the PLC or controller, and the I/O level, the sensor, actuator, motor, everything that we know very much well. So the area where RTA and our partner normally operate is more on the level 1 and 2. In this area, the industrial feedback connectivity are dedicated to the horizontal integration. Horizontal part of this integration, while the vertical communication normally with the SCADA, with the MES, with the ERP is normally done by other protocols like UPC UA, MT Connect, and others. So the network connectivity at the node level is the base of the pyramid, and it constitutes the essential element that support the entire integrated architecture. So now, what's next? What shall we expect in the future? So according with the today's trend, this five-layer separation will become more and more fading, in the meaning that the upper level of the pyramid gradually will move to cloud. While at the node level, we will see an increase of the intelligence and the capability of computing, which is called edge computing at the node level. The edge themselves, so the node, they will be able to talk each other directly, take decision in the real time, not necessarily going to the typical hierarchy of the communication layer that we saw, and the edge themselves, they will also able to connect directly to the cloud, or what it's called now edge to cloud connectivity. So big revolution. In this frame, so to conclude, the For all those reasons, we expect that the market of the industrial connectable device will continue to grow exponentially compared with any other traditional solution. And now, to introduce the next part of this session, I show you the result of a market share research made last year by the well-known HMS. Previously, it was called IMS. It's an independent company making global market research. The result is from last year, comparing the data from the year 2018. This is quite interesting. First of all, they divide the typology of network or protocol at the let's say field level into two major areas. They call field buses everything which is not industrial Ethernet-based. So let's call them the traditional field buses, while the industrial Ethernet-based protocol, the one that Pietro will show you later on, are the Ethernet IP, the PROFIN, and the Ethernet. So last year was real a turning point, because in a frame of a market that anyhow it's growing, we know it's growing so much, last year, for the first time, the traditional field buses got a contraction, -5% compared with the previous year for the first time, while the industrial Ethernet base are growing, and they are expecting to growing again so much. That small azure slice related to the wireless communication, still small, I expect from that some surprises in the next few years, when the 5G technology will enter massively into the industrial sector. But honestly, probably not so much in the real-time application, because for the real-time application, surely the industrial Ethernet, they will take again much, much bigger part of the slice. Now I leave the speech to our colleague Pietro Marinone from the Software and Technical Support Department, who will tell us about the protocol characteristics, classification, and selection criteria.
Thank you. Okay, I start with sharing my screen. Okay. And a little story of the protocols, because the industrial field buses start with the Modbus protocol made by Modicon in 1979. Field protocol is implemented on RS-485 as physical layer. The physical layer, it's a differential communication, because signaling to improve the resistance to the electromagnetic interference. And this is so important in industrial application. The more close protocol share the same physical level, it's the PROFIBUS. The PROFIBUS is used mostly by Siemens or Siemens application, and was developed in the 89 by a consortium, German consortium. Okay, and have the same physical layer. It's a serial bus. Serial bus means you need time to transfer the data. It's not all on the same time like parallel communication, but you need the time. In that case, if you see the bitrate, it's the number of the bits that are converted or processed units of time. Okay, this is the first two bus. In the 91, Cercos 1 is the first real-time bus, and real-time we arrive really soon with the definition. Use fiber optics as physical media. In the 94, CAN open bus use CAN as the physical layer and have a deterministic or real time, it's the same protocol. Okay. What is a deterministic protocol? Deterministic means the data transferred between devices occurs at predictable times. For example, 10 millisecond cycle, I have a fixed time. In 10 milliseconds, I have updated all the data of my slave. All Ethernet technologies are deterministic? No, because for example your laptop may use Ethernet while surfing web, but when you download a file you don't know for sure how many time you will use for it. Deterministic protocol are mandatory for industrial application? No, but some application can be done only with a real-time or deterministic protocol. For example, if you have more device on your net and you need to start perfectly synchronized some movements in case of motor or in case of pneumatic valve, you need to have a real-time bus or deterministic bus. Okay, CAN open, we will spend some time with this bus because it's open bus and introduce some concepts of a real-time bus. Okay, PDO as process data object means synced object, the critical object of your process. For example, start of movement, digital input, or what is the data you synch every times. SDO, service data object, you synch, you exchange this data only when the master request to a slave. For have less traffic on the net. But you have introduced with this protocol the emergency. Emergency is when a slave have an internal error, the slave can signal to the master the problem and master take in charge an action to solve the error. Okay, this what means you don't need from the master read every time the status word or error register to check if a slave have a fault, but the slave can send you the signal there is something gone wrong. Okay, and Now we see some Ethernet-based protocols. More open is EtherCAT and Modbus. Ethernet IP is open, but the cheap implementation of the Ethernet IP is not so much. Profinet have a consortium and it's not so much open. Circos and PowerLink about the same. And we have the other buses almost monobrand like CC-Link, AirTex, and Mechatrolink. In this table, we can see some difference of these Ethernet-based protocols. The baud rate is about the same. Here you can see the most common used. The CC-Link have in this table 1 gigabit per second because its implementation is only with there is real-time implementation. The CC-Link EATSN is only with 1 gigabit bus. Now we can see some buses have in the standard version real time and other it's another variant of the bus. In this case, we can see for Ethernet IP, we have the Ethernet IP chip version as real time. The Profinet ERT. Is the same performance about same performance of the EtherCAT, and we can see the maximum number of the slave nodes as a characteristic of the protocols. For Modbus TCP, Ethernet IP, and Profinet depends of the class of your IP and your network. With the Profinet architecture, we have three levels of real time. One is not real time. One is real time, but with a slow performance. And the ERT is about the EtherCAT performance. We have three levels. The ERT is for the drive, and the RT is for a little slow peripherals. And your bus is open. That table, it's old because it's off 4 years ago. But we can see the total number of companies participating in this bus and the manufacturing companies using this bus for communicate. We see the EtherCAT, it's the more open. After we have the Profinet ERT and Ethernet IP and other buses. Have no much companies. Now we see the IO link. What is the IO link? IO link is a bus for optimized, specialized for sensors. This what means the sensor can share some data, for example, start calibration of sensor, change the threshold, and more. It can be integrated in EtherCAT network by a gateway generally. And the future for the EtherCAT is the EtherCAT-G. EtherCAT-G enhance the performance of the EtherCAT to 1 gigabit for device require more performance and 10 gigabit for the most complex networks. Okay, now it's the turn of Raffaele, and thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Pietro. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to share my screen now. Okay, can you do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so
yes.
I'm going to talk about a specific bus protocol, the EtherCAT. We have seen before some of a broader view of industrial bus protocol, but now we are looking in a bit of detail, deeper into one of the preferred bus by RTA, and I will tell you why we prefer it over others. Of course, we have several offering. We have a wide range of solutions, but we think that EtherCAT is where we are going to give the most of our effort. So EtherCAT is an internet-based communication protocol and between industrial devices for real-time control. So what you see in the picture is what you have typically in a machine. So inside a machine you have several sensors and actuators. And these can be encoders, valves, load cell, thermoregulation, and motor drives, and many more. And a way to interconnect, there are several ways, of course, to interconnect them, and one is EtherCAT. What are the main features of EtherCAT? The first is that it is not expensive. The internet technology is widespread today and is almost everywhere, and the components have low cost. Of course, there are several kind of Ethernet interface. For example, the fiber optic version is one, and of course it is not low cost, but most of Ethernet is implemented over copper, and the cost in terms of connectors, cables, and integrated circuits and relative circuitry is actually low. It is reliable because Ethernet has proven to be a technology for industrial application use. We have seen it in the past 20 years, and many solutions are working very well with this technology. It's fast. The transfer rate is at 100 megabit per second. And on-the-fly data exchange is actually the best feature of the EtherCAT protocol. It is deterministic, so my colleague showed you before what this means to be deterministic, and this is very important in industry, in industrial machines. And another important point is that it is free. So it is free to use EtherCAT devices. If you are building a machine, you can freely integrate EtherCAT sensor or actuators or drives. And if you want to implement your own EtherCAT device, you need to apply for a membership to a consortium, the EtherCAT Technology Group, and that is actually free of charge. So let's look at an example of how an EtherCAT network is made up and how it works. So you can see at the bottom of the screen that we have a sample of EtherCAT network consisting of four devices, one master and three slaves. I call them devices, and they are just connected through a simple Ethernet cable in cascading. In this network, what happens? The master cyclically, and typically this happens each millisecond. Of course, it can be slower or faster, but a typical EtherCAT machine will have a cycle time of 1 millisecond. And what happens in this cycle, the master sends data to the devices, then receives back data from the devices, and according to this data, the master will elaborate them and performs control logic. And then again, it will send data and receive data, and again, it will do this as long as the machine is running. Of course, this is not something related only to EtherCAT. Actually, this is what all industrial protocol does, like Profinet or CANopen. And this is just to say that EtherCAT behaves in a similar way. What happens in a cycle, inside an EtherCAT cycle? The master generates a message, and you can see it in the picture. This message has always the same size and contains the data to be delivered to the devices. So the master is in charge of composing it, and it will fill it with several sections, and each section will be addressed to a specific device. So for example, you can see there the message, which has a part of data that is need to be sent to the first device, and other part of the message that are addressing other devices. And the master will send this message to the first device in the network. So what happens is that the device will receive it, will read the data from the master, and at the same time will update the same message with the response. With the response that the device want to give back to the master. And you can see that this is actually done very fast while the message is processed by the devices. When the device has read the data from the master, it can fill the data with the reply data in the same message, and then forward it to the next device in the network. The next device will do the same processing, so it will read its corresponding data and fill and replace the part of the message with its response, and again until the last device is reached. So when the last device has processed, completed processing the message, you can see that the message now has the data from all the devices, and this will come back to the master through the same Ethernet wiring. So how EtherCAT is deterministic? Each cycle is executed over a precise regular time interval. The message has always the same size, so that means that the network will process it always with the same time, Of course, with except for a small variance that is called jitter. And another feature of EtherCAT is that EtherCAT implements a distributed clock mechanism through which all devices will work with a shared clock. And the deviation here is less than 1 microseconds, but then you can think that this clock will be seen by all the devices in the network and will operate all together and at the same time. So if you send a target, if you want to set an output, they will do all at the same time, except for a small difference. Why EtherCAT is fast? Okay, the transfer happened at 100 megabits per second. This is the fast Ethernet technology, and this is actually what other Ethernet field bus protocol do. Of course, new version of it, gigabit and 10 gigabit, are going to arrive, will be available in the next years. Probably they will have advantages and disadvantages. One of them is that it will take much more power consumption. But the current technology is using mainly 100 megabits per second. The message is updated on the fly by each device. So while the message is passing, it will be processed with no delay. And also the full duplex nature of modern Ethernet avoids that delays and collisions happen. So no collision of half duplex, the message is forwarded with a small timing and forward and back through the Ethernet wirings, and this makes EtherCAT very fast. So what is the RTA offering with the field buses? We have a lot of devices working with EtherCAT. We have boxed and unboxed, so a drive separated from the motor. As you see there, the CSD, the smallest of its category, which is operating with a range of voltage from 24 to 48. Then bigger version such as the X Plus T, which works with 230 volt AC. We have a flex drive that is a stepping motor drive that fits in the Trio Motion technology architecture. Then we have boxed all-in-one drive and motor with batteryless absolute encoder like R-Mod and High-Mod T, and this works from voltage from ranging from 48 to more than 70, and all of this provides EtherCAT interface, of course, of different connector RJ40, 45, or M12 or M8. We have several models with CANopen protocol. Actually, they are all boxed iMod, and we are going to make available to all our customer distributors probably this year, Modbus TCP interface and Ethernet IP interfaces. So now my colleagues Pietro and Paolo Carnevale will show you a demo of how you can see an Ethercat solution with made with one brushless motor, and that will be accessed through a panel which offers a VPN connection, and you will see how Ethercat data, so bus data coming from the devices, the driver, will be available to view from an external network. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much, Raffaele. I think now we have a live demo by Pietro and Paolo, right? Pietro, you need to switch your microphone on. Pietro, okay. You need to switch your microphone and restart.
Okay, you see my screen now?
Yes, yes, sure. Yes. Now we can see. So what we are we doing at this moment?
Okay, now you see in the my screen the Paolo's application. Paolo are about 30 kilometers of distance, and I am taking the control of his application without have a computer to Paolo's home, because I'm using the VPN on our touch panel, and now we try. Okay, we have turn on the display. Okay, and now I start his motor. Okay, now we can see some parameters on the motor, like encoder temperature or internal temperature of the amplifier. Other parameter you can see in this case is the life of the dynamic brake and the relay for the inrush current. And now we can do more, because I can open the motion control program, and for example plot, change motor parameters, check if there is some problem of in my application, stop all the motion, and so much. You can see now the temperature moving the motor is increasing, and we have done it without Paolo need to configure nothing on his net, and now Paolo can tell you something.
Yes, the point is that with this kind, excuse me, I'm trying to.
One second. Okay.
Okay, I was trying to switch on my camera. The point is that if we have an industrial network, and we have a component that can use the industrial network to communicate, and we can send the data about the motor, about the drive, about the work of the system and the work of the machine through the normal stack of net, that is internal net of the plant, of the production plant, and out of that external internet, we can do Industry 4.0 application that allow to check the health of a machine, and also can allow to make evaluation of the need of maintenance on the status of the machine, and so knowing if something is overheating, something needed to be changed in. And this is the basis, but the basis is having network communication pipeline that allow to have the data from the field going up to the plant, up to the internet, and up to the producer of a machine or supervisor system, supervising system, and that's the point. It's the real need of having a working net, industrial net, is the possibility to switch data between the place in which you have the data. Okay, and I think is that's all.
And let me add that this was a demo sending a few parameters starting from the motor itself. But imagine to have this replicated in a real machine with many axes, several machines located all around the world. Theoretically, the system, well organized, of course, should be able to collect data in the real time from all of them located all around the world and send to the cloud, for example, also to run some statistics, and also to run something that is one of the milestones of the industry 4.0, which is the predictive maintenance. So due to looking at the usage of the parts on different machinery, you have be able to see how much one machine was used compared with other, in which environment, the temperature of the part, and so on. And these are information really, really important for the reliability of the parts. Okay. Now I switch the recording off, and we can go to the question and answer session.